Okay, good morning. Okay, so to continuing my pedagogical lecture. So last time I discussed quantum thermalization. And today I'm going to focus on the other sort of known and understood generic dynamic phase of closed quantum many-body systems, which is many-body localization. Right? And remember what I mean by generic. I mean a situation which is structurally stable to making small local short-range perturbations to the system's Hamiltonian or Floquet operator. Okay. Now, of course, this goes back to Anderson. Can you see the board? You can hear me? Okay. So in 1958, Phil Anderson was thinking about, in the 1950s, that's when this was at Bell Labs, semiconductors were just invented, and people were starting to dope semiconductors, and, look what was going on in semiconductors, and semiconductors are just insulators. And so you can put dilute in dopants in a semiconductor, and they'll have electrons on them, which have a spin. And the electrons, if you're at low temperatures and they're far enough apart, there'll be no charge transport. So it'll still be an insulator, but you'll have these spins. Okay, so you make basically dilute spins randomly placed. Is this on? Yes. Randomly placed in an insulator. So this is a regime of doped semiconductors, right? And then in the 50s also, people were starting to do resonance experiments. So they would look at the resonance lines of these spins and they ask what the line widths are and what was setting the line widths. So that was the physics that was being thought about at the time. What Phil did in this paper, he basically, let's think about this in the way I was discussing it yesterday. So the idea here is you have, what does it mean? Okay, so what we have here is the spins, which are interacting with each other. Okay, so in the material, you have a spin. This was mentioned, I think Kedar was talking about this yesterday. You have two spins, and if they're nearby, there's an interaction between them via super exchange. So you have spin-spin interactions, and you could have a magnetic field. So this would include, when I say the spin Hamiltonian, I mean the interactions of the spins with each other and also with an applied magnetic field, and you have a Zeeman term. But then the isolation, which Anderson was proposing, is ignore spin phonon. So ignore the coupling of the spins to any other degrees of freedom. And at low temperatures in a semiconductor, this is a reasonably good approximation. The spin energetics is some low energy scale, and there's not a lot of phonons around, and the spins don't couple strongly to them. And so he asked in this paper, so the original 1958 paper by Anderson, the problem he was working on was this spin problem, and it is a many-body problem. So he was doing many-body physics, and the first localization was many-body localization. And the temperatures, although it was low temperatures, it wasn't low temperature compared to the spin-spin interactions, because the spin-spin interactions, when the spins are dilute, they fall off exponentially with the distance, and so they were quite weak. And so the experiments he was thinking about were high-temperature experiments relative to the physics that was being included here. And so he asked the question I mentioned yesterday. basically, I'm going to put it in my language, not his, is this many spin system a functioning reservoir. And he realized that it didn't have to be true. The answer to this question could be no, right? The conventional answer to this question is yes, right? You have a many degrees of freedom system that are interacting. You wait long enough, it'll go to equilibrium. That's the conventional thing, right? And that was the conventional idea. But he basically said, no, we shouldn't assume that such a system, even though it's interacting, we shouldn't assume it's a heat bath. We should ask, does it actually succeed in doing that? And he developed a scenario, which is Anderson localization, which is the answer. So if no, this is localization, right? And that's what localization was to begin with. Now he made in that paper after, thinking about the many body problem, he said, let's make the approximation of looking at, we have our system in some state and we think of one spin flip and then ask what's the dynamics of a single spin flip hopping around amongst these spins. And so he reduced it in a certain approximation to a single particle problem. And that's what he was able to really make some progress on theoretically. And that's what, when people now say Anderson localization, that's what they mean. It wasn't a particle hopping in a random potential that he was originally doing at all. It was a spin excitation moving in a random spin environment, which in an approximation where it ended up being mathematically equivalent to a particle hopping in a random potential. So localization, and so what is Anderson localization? It is reservoir failure. Right? That's really what Anderson localization is, and it's what it was in the original paper. Yeah.
Yeah. So this calculation was in how many dimensions?
Three. Original,
three dimensions. Okay.
Three. Yeah.
Yeah. Because mapping this spin halves to non-interacting, spinless electrons, that is generally done in 1D, this Jordan Wigner. So this was not...
Yeah, no, he wasn't, of course this was 1958, yeah. Right? I don't know if Jordan and Wigner had done theirs. Well, maybe they had by then, I don't know. Okay. But no, it was just an approximation. It wasn't a controlled calculation. It was Phil Anderson, right? Phil Anderson isn't based on controlled calculations. It's based on intuition and self-confidence. And also being correct, usually. I'm allowed to say that since he's my colleague. He's 92 years old and he comes in every day, goes to the seminars, etc. Actually, just a little bit about localization. Some people might know about Anderson localization, and so it's important to talk about a little bit to say, I'm focusing on many-body localization, which is one version of Anderson localization, and it's not the standard one, okay? So in my view, broadly speaking, there are three sort of Anderson localization problems that have received a lot of attention. Okay, one is non-interacting particles. Or linear waves, right? So this is the, if you have a non-interacting particle, it's a Schrödinger equation, which is a wave equation. And so, this kind of Anderson localization also applies to just classical waves. So there's acoustic, you can localize acoustic waves or whatever. And this is almost all theory work, say before 2013, on Anderson localization is about this problem. Okay. The second problem that's received a lot of attention is ground state with interactions. And this goes under the name of, say, the metal insulator transition, or superconductor insulator. And this is almost all experiments on localization are about this problem here. So this is a ground state, this is a class of ground state quantum phase transitions where you have just two ground state phases, one of which is conducting and one of which is insulating, right? Or maybe superconducting. And so there's a big literature on this. And here, you know, of course, the real experimental systems have interactions. And so there's been a lot of thought about with interactions in the context of ground states. And you know, there's actually a bunch of theory work here as well. So you know, when I say almost all theory work, I don't mean almost all in the mathematical sense, right? Right? There's a set of non-zero measure which goes down here, theoretically. And then the third problem, which is the one I'm going to talk about today, is highly excited, meaning excitation energies above the ground state that, if they thermalized, would correspond to non-zero temperature, highly excited and interacting. So put in, you know, both the difficulties, right? This stuff, regular Anderson localization, there's no interactions, but it considers all energies. Here, there is interactions, but it's focused just on the ground state. Here, it's both, all energies and with interactions. And this is what's now called MBL. So I often make my title be many body Anderson localization because, of course, it is Anderson localization. You know, it's right there in the original paper. But because of the history where when you say Anderson localization, people almost always mean this problem. So that's why this is just called many body localization, just to give it a distinction. All of these would be disorder. Well, you don't have to have disorder. Of course, you can have, so there's the André Aubry model. So there's these models where you have a quasi-periodic potential. So you have a lattice and then a potential with a period which is incommensurate with the lattice. So it's not really disordered, but nor is it translationally invariant. So you don't have Bloch's theorem. And you still have the Anderson localization. So it doesn't have to be disordered, but it can't be translationally invariant. Because if it's translationally invariant, these insulators are Anderson insulators. They're not mod insulators. Of course, there's ground state insulators in translationally invariant system, which are mod insulators, which are due to interactions only and not disorder. But that's really different physics. So when I say the insulator we're talking about here is a mod insulator, not a is an Anderson. It's an insulator due to either randomness. It's an insulator due to the system not being translationally invariant, right? Yeah. There's also Okay. And this is a topic. So in terms of the history here, there was a very important paper, Bosco, Elena, Altshuler. So 48 years later, the problem got brought back to the attention of a broad community of physicists. And you know, at least in my opinion, it was this paper that launched it as a modern research subject. And it's been going since then. So MBL occurs in 1D at high T. When I say temperature, I mean energies that would correspond to that temperature if the system thermalized. So when I talk about low temperature and high temperature, I really mean low energy, high energy. But you know, we're more used to thinking about temperature, and also even T equals infinity. So we can even go to infinite temperatures and see this physics. And this is fortunate. So this is actually our first work. So Oganessian, Hughes, 2007. So basically, this work was done. He had just left Princeton. He had been a postdoc at Princeton, and he was friends with Vadim, who was a postdoc at Princeton. So Vadim knew about this and said, oh, let's work on that. That looks really exciting. And so we started working on it, and we realized you can study this stuff numerically thanks to, we had done this work before with Subroto that I mentioned yesterday, looking at quantum dynamics at very high energies in one dimension. We were doing translationally invariant system and doing thermalization, even though we didn't know what we should call it that. And so Vadim said, we've got these tools, they work really well. Let's look at the localization problem. And we quickly realized that in 1D, you can actually study this rather nicely numerically. So this feature that it can occur in 1D at high energies where you have a lot of states, you do an exact diagonalization, you get a lot of data, right? So when you do exact diagonalizations and you're studying properties near the ground state in random systems, you don't get very many eigenstates, and the statistics are kind of lousy. Whereas when you work at high temperatures and you diagonalize a Hamiltonian, you get an enormous number of eigenstates. So just diagonalizing one Hamiltonian can give you very good statistics. And then in 1D, you can actually diagonalize chains which are 16 sites long, and so you're probing length scales much larger than the lattice spacing. And so this allows the whole phenomenon to be reasonably accessible to numerics, although it's not under great control, but it's at least makes it so you're testing it somewhat numerically. Yeah, what spin chain? That's my next thing I want to say. Okay, so we did a particular spin chain in this model, but then there was subsequent work. Okay, so I'm gonna mention one model that I like to call the standard model of MBL. Okay, and so this is. Well, let me just mention some names. So there's a paper from Slovenia, Snedarić et al., 08, and then Arjit Paul and myself, 2010. So we looked at this model. So this is what I call standard model of MBL. So this is a standard model in a very different sense than the standard model of particle physics or the standard model of cosmology. One of the great things about MBL, which is not so great when you're doing the numerics, is it's completely general physics, and so you have absolutely no guidance as to what model you should be looking at, right? And you have an enormous freedom in what model to look at, and there have been a lot of different models looked at, and it's not clear what are the best models to look at. But there is one particular model that has received a lot more attention than any others, and so it's really the standard model just because it's good when multiple people are working on the same problem that they work on the same model sometimes so that they can compare their results, right? So that's really the only virtue of this model is a sociological statement that a consensus came. When we want to compare results to other people, we look at this model because that's what, the majority, or the plurality, what's the word? If you ask what model's been studied the most, it's this model. So it's a spin a half chain. Sorry. Yeah, go on.
So when you say t goes to infinity, so when you have a lattice model with finite number of sites or whatever, so you have some sort of bandwidth, right?
Yeah.
Temperatures above that bandwidth don't really make that much sense, right? So what exactly do you mean by t going to infinity?
I mean, diagonalize the Hamiltonian and use every single eigenstate you get and give them all equal weight.
Oh, okay.
Which is exactly what you would do if you were doing t equals infinity and doing a Boltzmann distribution.
Yeah, okay.
So that's what I mean.
Oh, okay.
And also, the average energy of the states you're looking at corresponds thermodynamically to the energy you would have at infinite temperature.
Okay, yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. So, spin a half chain. Hamiltonian sum over I. So just the standard Heisenberg spin chain. Just like Heisenberg solved, not Heisenberg, beta solved. And then we put a random field only along the z direction. And then hi. Traditionally in this field, it's kind of maybe Arajit's fault. The field, so these are static random fields, and they're chosen uniformly between two limits centered on zero. It probably would have been better if it had been always a Gaussian. Not an important difference, but somehow Gaussians, if you're picking random variables, why not pick them Gaussian? So this is kept non-random. You could make it random, right? Of course, people have studied this where it's random, and that's the important thing. But to get localization, typically you just need to make one of the terms in the Hamiltonian sufficiently random, and you get localization. And so this is a model that's often studied. Some of the studies, this is made XXZ, so the coupling of the Z components of the spin is different than the XY. But the Heisenberg case is used, of course, this breaks the symmetry, so you don't have the full Heisenberg symmetry as soon as you put on this random field, but this is what's often done. No, not at all. Because we're at infinite temperature, and so an antiferromagnet at infinite temperature is the same as a ferromagnet at infinite temperature, right? And the fields are randomly up or down, right? And so I could multiply this H by minus one, and the physics doesn't change at all, because that's just going to the opposite temperature, which at infinite temperature is the same temperature, right? So yes, right, this could be ferromagnet or antiferromagnet, doesn't matter. Okay, so this particular model has two conservation laws, which are the energy itself and the total Z component of the spin. So it has a hydrodynamics with two conserved quantities, which is nice if you want to study transport. It's nice to have conserved quantities so you can look at sum over I, yes. Thank you. Right. Okay, this model has a phase diagram. So in this field, we draw phase diagrams, but they're not thermodynamic phase diagrams. They are phases which are distinguished not by their thermodynamic properties, but by the properties of the dynamics and also by the properties of the eigenstates. So we could call this an eigenstate or a dynamical phase diagram. And I'll start by putting only one I'll put a second axis for later use, but start by only putting one axis here, H over J. Okay. And so I'm going to start at, let me just label this axis. So this is the energy, and here's zero. So at infinite temperature in a model like this, at infinite temperature, all states are equally likely, and in a model like this, the average energy is zero because the average of this term over all states is zero, and the average of this term over all states is zero, right? So infinite temperature corresponds to zero energy, and let me just focus on that. And so what we have here are the localized phase here, a transition, poorly understood phase eigenstate phase transition or dynamic phase transition, which is at current estimates 4 plus or minus 1 on this axis. And then we have the thermal phase over here. And then actually there's a special point here which is integrable. So that point is, this point here is no random field. That's the first non-trivial many-body physics ever done. Hans Bethe, 1931, solved that problem. That's the origin of the Bethe ansatz. So this is an integrable point. As far as we know, you add small random fields, it crosses over to thermal. This crossover here is an interesting problem, like I mentioned yesterday, but I'm not going to talk about that. Well, it's a question is, it's singular perturbation as far as we know, right? So that you treat that perturbatively, presumably it destabilizes the integrability, turns it over to thermalizing. Nobody has really fully controlled that perturbation theory. You know, it's an interesting problem. Maybe, you know, I think, you know, people are thinking about it, and you know, maybe that's something that progress will happen someday. But let's leave it aside because that's not today's topic.
What did you write just about the critical point?
That's just the value. That's a number, 4. 4 plus or minus 1. It's not obvious, and this is so there is a phase transition here which is very poorly understood. We don't have a theory of it. We have numerical data with strong finite size effects, but we don't have a theory of it, so we don't have a finite size scaling theory of it. So yeah, we don't know a lot about it. It certainly looks like there's just two phases in a phase transition, but there is a lot of room in there for something else to be happening that we don't understand. There aren't any serious ideas that are developed to any extent saying there's something other than this, but you know, I think it's an open question. Yeah.
So operationally, how do you get to E equal to zero? You just average over all eigenstates with equal weight, or?
Yeah. So what we do in the numerics is you just take a realization of this Hamiltonian, draw numbers from this interval, diagonalize the Hamiltonian, you get all the eigenstates, that's a lot of data, and actually what we do typically is we take the states, the middle half of the spectrum, so we throw out the top quarter and the bottom quarter because those correspond to low temperature and we want to study high temperature. That's not too important, but it removes a little bit of the finite size effects. And we just study, you know, half of the eigenstates we got, and we just give them all equal weight and average over them, right? And that's actually one of the nice things is because, you know, you diagonalize one chain of length 16, you get a lot of data. And you can measure quantities, and the error bars are pretty small once you do this averaging because it's just a lot of data.
And if I wanted to do the dynamical version of this, I would start with an initial state,
yeah,
which need not be an eigenstate, but which has, yeah, energy content which is high.
Yeah.
Right? And then, yeah, yeah, I would try.
Right. And so this you can do, right, once you've diagonalized it, you have the spectrum, you have the states, you can do any dynamics you want. Right? As you know, often what one does is start from a product state, and there you use everything, right? So you don't throw out the lower energy states. You know, if that's in there, you just do it. So you start with a product state, and then you just let it evolve and see, does it thermalize or does it stay localized? How does the I'm going to talk about this stuff. How does the entanglement move, et cetera? So now there is a limit, which is this limit over here, where the random fields are large compared to the interactions. And so this is a trivially localized limit, which is J equals 0, H not equal to 0, right? So if I have these random fields and I don't have this, that's a Hamiltonian you could diagonalize. It's just a spin in a field. You know, that's one of the simplest Hamiltonians to solve for. And so what happens here? Okay, dynamics is just each spin Larmor processes in the magnetic field. So each spin has a field along the z-axis and it processes about that. So that's the, and they're all processing at different frequencies. No transport. So each spin has an energy and it has a z component of its spin and that doesn't change with time. So there's no transport of the conserved quantities. It's clearly an insulator, a localized phase. Yeah, dynamically.
Question about the y-axis again. So if you're lower than infinite temperature, the energy is lower? So your E is going...
Yeah, this would be also beta. Minus beta.
Okay.
Yeah, right, minus beta. So positive temperature is... Temperatures can be positive or negative, right? And the positive temperatures connect to the negative temperatures not at zero, but at infinity. And zero temperature is a very singular point, right? Because zero plus epsilon and zero minus epsilon are totally different states, right? So beta should be used.
In principle, the critical point also can depend on temperature.
Yeah, right. Let's ignore the vertical axis for a few minutes before I fill in the rest of the phase diagram. Because most of the physics is already here without adding this extra thing, okay?
And this is quite robust with respect to the distribution of the order, right?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. It probably can be binary. And in fact, you don't even need disorder. You could just have a quasi-periodic potential, right? So these HIs could just be cosine of an irrational wave vector times the position, and that would be enough to get this physics, right? And the difference isn't, that's one thing we've been studying, comparing quasi-periodic to random with the same distribution, right? So if I make this cosine of an angle, I can have the angle go uniformly along the chain, quasi-periodic, or I could just have the angle be random, get the same distribution of the fields, compare the two problems. The differences are typically, on the sizes you can study, the differences are rather small. So it seems very robust in one dimension to all those kinds of changes. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so this clearly doesn't thermalize. Okay, the eigenstates, what are the eigenstates? They're just random strings of ups and down spins. Right? The eigenstates look like that. Okay, a typical eigenstate is at an average energy of zero. It corresponds to infinite temperature. At infinite temperature, if the system thermalized, each spin should be randomly up or down with probability a half. But in each of these eigenstates, that's not true. Each spin is definitely up or definitely down. So these clearly violate ETH. Right? In an eigenstate like this, each spin looks like it's at zero temperature, but some look like they're at zero temperature positive, and some look like they're at zero temperature negative, and the total energy looks like it's at infinite temperature. So it's definitely not a thermal state. Okay? And it is integrable. And the simplest constants of motion are just the individual z components of the spin. Right? So it has a bunch of localized conserved quantities, which are just the z components of the spins, right? So that's pretty simple, okay? And this is the essence of the many-body localized phase, although the real many-body localized phase has more physics than that. You know, it's a limit of it. There's a lot of other interesting stuff happening that's not here that I want to tell you about. But this is a good first approximation for thinking about it.
But you don't need disorder.
Right, but in order for this to be okay, so now turn on small j. If you had no disorder, you would get all sorts of resonances, and this would be a singular perturbation, right? Whereas if you have the disorder, so this couples two spins, which are next to each other, right? Just think of the two-spin problem, right? I have this spin, I have H1 on this spin, H2 on this spin, and a J here. Now, if the H1 and H2 are different, then I have four eigenstates at J equals zero, which are at energies plus or minus H1 and plus or minus H2, right? There's two choices here, two choices there, and there's no degeneracies, right? And so then I turn on the J and the eigenstates hardly change, right? But as soon as I have no disorder, I get a degeneracy, right? Which of course is total S z equals zero, this guy up, and you get this flip-flop, and so there's a resonance. And so turning on small j is a perturbation which is very different in the random problem than in the non-random problem, right? Okay, and so this is basically what so these guys here, they were doing a different model, but the calculation they did, you can apply to this model, and it corresponds to this, turn on small j, start with something that's non-interacting, turn on weak interactions, treat it perturbatively, try to make good arguments in the style of their nation, carrying perturbation theory to infinite order and trying to look for every possibility and make an argument that there's no problem, perturbation theory is fine. And that's what they did. So system remains localized up to some value of j. And then you do the numerics, you go far enough, you realize it thermalizes at some point. So system remains localized. Okay. And what happens is these eigenstates here get dressed with quantum fluctuations. So there will be quantum fluctuations where these two spins exchange, right? If these two fields happen to be almost equal, then this exchange will get mixed in quite a bit in perturbation theory. And so you have all those fluctuations happening there to all orders, which just correspond to rearrangements of the spins. Well, okay, so ultimately There's a proof, not for this specific model, but for another spin chain by John Imbrie. And the proof is that there is a local unitary which maps the eigenstates to the product states. So you have the exact eigenstates. There is a unitary which maps them to the product states, and that unitary is, in a certain sense, localized. It doesn't contain long-range rearrangements. So that's, I think, the nicest way to formulate it. Of course, that's not the way they put it at all, but I think that's the nicest way to formulate it, at least from my point of view. Right. Get dressed. This produces short-range entanglement. But only short-range, right? So unlike the thermal eigenstates we have over here, where the entanglement is long-range, you take a region of length L, it has entanglement proportional to L. Here, if we look in real space, you know, and take a region of length L in an eigenstate and ask how much it's, so they say this is S and this is S bar over here, like from yesterday, and ask how much this region is entangled with that, it will only be entangled due to quantum fluctuations in the vicinity of this cut and in the vicinity of this cut. And so the entanglement will not be proportional to the length of the system. It'll be just boundary law entanglement. So boundary law. Entanglement. So like a ground state. So the eigenstates stay like ground states in that respect. Ground states of quantum many-body systems with short-range interactions have only boundary law entanglement. They don't have long-range entanglement. Or they might only, you know, they don't have a lot of long-range entanglement. Okay? Okay. The conserved spins, SIZ, they also get dressed with higher order terms, which are spin flip type terms. And we produce conserved pseudo spins, which we call tau, tau iz, which commute with the Hamiltonian.
Yeah.
And then there's, for the random system, the amount of entanglement is a random variable. From sample to sample and eigenstate to eigenstate, it's a random variable, and it has tails to large entanglement. And that's a subject we're trying to get under some control. You expect those tails converge exponentially with the amount of entanglement. We're trying to investigate that carefully and try to teach matrix product DMRG type methods to actually do that calculation in a way that's really under control. And so that's sort of where we are right now. But so far, the numerics is all exact diagonalization. The matrix product state methods, which they work, but they only work to the extent that they agree with the exact diagonalizations, and they so far have not worked to the extent that they are better than the exact diagonalizations in terms of giving us some physics knowledge that we couldn't get from the exact diagonalizations. You know, those of you who know ground state exact diagonalizations, when matrix product states, when Steve White invented the DMRG and matrix product states came in, it was a total revolution because you could do things that were just way beyond what you could do with exact diagonalizations. It hasn't happened yet here. I'm hoping it will, but maybe there's some fundamental issues which will make that so it can't happen. But if it can't happen, there's some interesting physics behind that. So this project of trying to do it, I think, is a win-win. It's either it's going to work and we're going to learn something, or it's not going to work and we're going to learn something about why it didn't work, right? And that, and either way, it's new physics, I think. You know, maybe I'm being overly optimistic, but But that's sort of in the future still, but I think it's the very near future because there's a lot of activity. Okay, so that's part of that project. Okay, so this is a phenomenology, a heuristic. Nobody doubts that it's true. If there is such a unitary mapping from the eigenstates to the product states, that defines those pseudospins, right? And so in some sense, they do exist automatically for any system, even if it's not localized. But the question is, what's the optimal way of defining them where they are most localized, right? If you try to do that in the thermal phase, you can't get any construction where these guys are localized, right? You know, you try to define them, and they're always operators which are completely all over the whole system. They're not observables, right? Whereas the special property of the localized phase is you can find a set, one for each site, of conserved operators that are actually observables, right? But we don't know the best construction for making them. And that's part of the project of, understanding this stuff in more detail is there's various ansatzes for constructing them which have been carried out in the exact idealization. But I don't know, they might have problems, right? It might be they're suboptimal in some way. So this is again at the edge of where we are.
But the belief is that there's one per site and not one per two sites.
Well, there's actually more than one per site because tau 1z times tau 2z times tau 3z is a different operator which is linearly independent of each of these guys and is also conserved. So there are actually many more than one per site of conserved operators which are linearly independent operators. But if you can make one per site, then you can just build up all these others.
This unitary transformation.
It's only going to exist for small j before the phase transition.
Sure.
Beyond the phase transition, it doesn't exist as local. It exists, but it's not local. Whereas over here, it's local. And local with tails, right? It's not strictly local. It's a unitary which rearranges things. It's what you call a disentangler. There's quantum information people do this, right? They make operators that disentangle things, right? And so this is a disentangler. It maps the eigenstates onto product states. And it does that, by operations which are localized, meaning they only act locally but with some tails, which fall off strongly enough so that it's sensible to call it localized.
So is this similar to like in classical systems, where you have start with integrable systems and you have this camtor, right, and this kind of survive when you switch on a...
Yeah, in some sense, yeah, this is like... So the KAM is interesting in that KAM works for systems with a finite number of degrees of freedom. You do have this threshold where the KAM tori survive up to some point. Probably in the limit of infinitely many degrees of freedom, you don't have that threshold. Now, so we really have two integrable systems here. We have this guy, which I said earlier, doesn't survive breaking. So there's no KAM threshold here, we believe. We don't know. Whereas we've got this other integrable system over here, which does, right? Now, here, because it's localized, in some sense, when I turn on the interactions, I'm only dealing with a system of a few degrees of freedom, right? Because it doesn't interact with everything else. It only interacts locally, right? And so that would be a reason that a KAM-like threshold could exist over here when it doesn't exist over here. Because here, all these integrals of motion, they're all, they're currents, they're integrals over the whole system. Right, there's no localized integrals of motion in the beta ansatz, right? Those are all extended states. right? And so as soon as you turn on the interaction, they all interact with each other. And it's a many degrees of freedom problem, no KAM threshold as far as we know. Whereas over here, yes. Yeah, the MBL phase is an integrable system of a sort, but it's different than the traditional integrable systems, whereas here we have a Hamiltonian. Each Hamiltonian has its own integrals of motion, and even if I just change the parameters, the integrals of motion change, right? In the beta ansatz solvable models, you know, when you go in a parameter in the space, the integrals of motion just change smoothly. You know, they're just functions of the parameters. Whereas over here, these integrals of motion, they're more non-trivial, right? They're very, I call them emergent, right? You know, each sample has its own integrals of motion, and the construction of them is highly non-trivial, right? And we don't fully understand it yet, right? At least this is the picture, right? You know, I guess Spenta's not here today. You know, when he realized yesterday that I wasn't proving anything, but you know, is he? Okay. It's pretty clear today that I'm just talking and not proving anything, right? Right. Right, bigger. Okay, I'll try to. Yeah, he's so far in the back, right? Yeah.
Then, in some sense, you just created an integrable model with taus as the conserved quantity.
Yeah, yeah.
But the problem is that taus are extended usually.
Well, here the taus are extended, but here they're localized.
Right.
Yeah.
So that does this mean that if I'm able to rewrite my Hamiltonian in such that I create n local integrals of motion,
localized
integrals of motion, then for sure the system is MBL in the MBL phase.
Yeah. That's right.
Okay.
Right, so. Because if I have a localized integral of motion, I can make a subsystem that contains most of it, and then I can put it in a non-thermal state, and it'll stay in a non-thermal state because it's conserved. Right? Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. So these, Vadim, or we call L bits for localized bits, right? So, you know, we were thinking, you know, this is sort of quantum information stuff. So we're talking about pseudo spins, which is like a qubit. And so we call these L bits, right? They're localized bits, right? The system has these two-level systems in there, which are stable. You could put quantum information on one of these, and it could stay there forever. You know, that's one of the big interests in many-body localization, is because of these properties, even though it's strongly interacting, you can write quantum information on a subsystem, and it can stay there forever, right? And so you know, this might be a useful type of thing for quantum information tasks, right? And so we call these L bits, localized bits, right? And they're sort of, in some sense, spontaneously localized, okay? And this general picture here, so there's a paper, Serbin, Popich, Abanin, 13, and then ours is Hughes, Nankishore, Oganessian. So O is Oganessian, 14. Right, and the eigenstates of if we have these pseudospins, the eigenstates again look just like this when written in terms of the pseudospins. Right? So if we know what the pseudospins are, we know what the eigenstates look like. They just look like a random bit strings where the pseudospins are just randomly up or down. Right? So this picture of the eigenstates stays valid, provided just you say this is the pseudospins as opposed to the bare spins. Okay, so now I'm going to decorate this phase diagram a little more. So now if we ask what happens when we go off this axis, okay, so this is now, there's now a bit of a controversy about this, but the consensus picture, which is being doubted for reasons that I'm not so sure I believe, is that the phase diagram looks like this. So it's MBL here and MBL here. So we have a thermal phase. When you're in the thermal phase, at where the density of states is high, it's delocalized, but when you go to the band tails, it's localized. Just like in the single particle problem, for people who know that, if you have some band, it could be localized in the middle of the band, but sorry, it could be delocalized, which corresponds to thermal, in the middle of the band, and get localized out in the band tails. And that, we believe, happens in the many-body problem as well. And then if that does happen, this is what we call a many-body mobility edge. Meaning the eigenstates as a function of energy change from localized to thermalizing as a function of energy in the same Hamiltonian. So it's a feature in the spectrum of a given Hamiltonian separating localized states and extended states. Okay? And this divides the Hamiltonians into two parts. Over here, I put an F there, and this means fully. All states are localized. And when all states are localized, then these pseudospins exist, right? Because these pseudospins, if these pseudospins exist, there are 2 to the L eigenstates for a chain of length L, which are these guys, right? So if the pseudospins exist, all the eigenstates are localized. Whereas over here, if there's a many-body localized phase in the band tails but not in the center, we have many-body localization, but we don't have all these conservation laws, right? So down here, the idea is you would still have a unitary that maps these eigenstates onto product states, but it will only do that for some subset of the eigenstates, not for the whole spectrum, right? And so therefore, you don't have operators, because to have a conserved operator which commutes, it means it commutes on the whole spectrum, not on just a subspectrum, right? So this region here, where you don't have the conserved quantities, but you still have MBL, is a little harder to understand phenomenologically. And I think partly because of that reason, there have been some doubts raised. And so some people have proposed, Marcus Müller and François Houvenier, Wojciech Dyruk, have proposed, no, this doesn't really exist, and the phase boundary is just, you know, the Hamiltonians are either all states localized or none localized. But I want to mention that just because that's out there and being discussed. But my prejudice now is this picture. But this is an open question. Yeah.
So a question here. So you're in the MBL phase, let us say, near this mobility edge.
Down here.
Yeah, let's say down there.
Yeah.
Then you project on to the smaller Hilbert space.
Yeah.
In just that energy sector. And then try to do this sort of localized qubits. So is that...
I don't know how to do that. You know, you can say I have a local unitary which maps all these eigenstates onto product states.
Okay.
Right, but the problem is the set of product states you make is just a very small number of the product states, so you can't then use those to construct these operators.
Yeah, there may not be as many as many conserved quantities as the number of sites. There may be fewer, right? Meaning, if you
would be nice
project
if,
it onto
it would be nice if you could construct one of them.
Yeah.
But nobody, to my knowledge, has yet figured out how to do that, right? And so. You know, the question is there such a picture, or do we just have to drop it all together? Yeah. This isn't clear.
Yeah. Thanks.
So why is it difficult to check which line is correct? I mean, you said that, there's some controversy whether this is the correct line or the dashed line is correct. I mean, where does the difficulty lies, to check, which...
You're talking about in the numerics?
Yeah.
It comes out here. You know.
But if I just go...
First of all, we don't have a theory of the phase transition. We have very small systems. We have to do finite size scaling theory, But there is no finite size scaling theory.
Yeah, but I understand.
So what we do is we just do finite size scaling theory as if it was a traditional phase transition, but it might not be, right? And so we don't know what we're doing, and we have big error bars.
That's only
and so so the line could be straight or it could curve, and that's all within the errors.
That's only near there, right? If I just go far from...
Oh, no, if you go away, the error bars get bigger, right? So the error bars, right, here you have good statistics. Here the density of states goes down, so the statistics get terrible as you move away from this axis. So that's why most of the work, they don't even try to get off of this infinite temperature axis, because that's where the good statistics are. Trying to move away, the error bars just grow rapidly as you move away, right? And so basically, you know, there's a, you know, error bars on here which are perfectly consistent with either scenario. And I think that's, you know, in the paper that's raising this issue, they make that point, and that I agree with, that numerically there's no clear answer to this question, right? It's and you know, I don't know if it's going to be answered, and whether it's going to come from theory or maybe better numerics isn't clear. Kedar.
The impression one gets is that no many body localization is a highly non-generic one. Is that just reflecting your current thinking, or is that really very, very non-generic?
Well, no, that's the question. Is the generic thing it curves, or is the generic thing it's just straight? Yeah. That's the open question, right? And the majority of people who have written about this say this is the generic behavior and this should not happen, but then there are reasons, you know, because clearly this is different than this, right? So you can have this is stable, but this is unstable, right? And you know, I think it's an open point. I'm telling you my bias, but it's, you know, I'm trying to, you know, mention alternate points of view where I think they're, you know, quite, you know, pretty likely to, or not likely, but you know, have a reasonable chance of actually being right.
And in Imbri's proof, the proof is implying fully.
The proof is only valid. You know, of course, it's one of these mathematical physics proof, which is really controlled, and so it has bounds, and the bounds are like, you know, super far from the transition, right? So it doesn't help. He's aware of this. I said, you know, if you can make a proof down here, right, perturb up from here, you know, the ground state's localized, and he can probably prove that. Question is, can he control the perturbation this way? And he's aware of this, but I haven't heard from him.
And you cannot see if the low energy part of the spectrum is localized with other methods like the lamsos or which are more powerful.
Well, the ground state is localized, because it's a random system, and in one-dimensional random systems, the ground states are localized almost always, right? And so there's going to be, so the question is, as you move away from the ground state, is it just some crossover like this one, some non-perturbative effect makes it thermalize, or does it actually stay localized for a while before thermalizing? And this is just a hard thing to control.
So you would like to see it as a localized up to
an energy that corresponds to a non-zero temperature, right? So this axis is beta, or it's E over the length of the system, right? So this is the energy density on this axis. That's an important thing. The mobility edge is at an energy which is an energy density, right? It's not like the single particle problem where it's an energy scale of order one. Here it's an extensive energy.
Singlet ground state is that's bi-localized in some way.
Those guys are kind of marginal.
Okay.
Yeah. One issue is are there actual localized phase which correspond to random singlets? You know, there are some arguments. In this case, I come down on the side against localization that random singlet-like phases are not stable to many-body localization. Although I've written a paper to the contrary, but now my opinion is the opposite. But again, this is one of these open questions.
Is this because even in the ground state, there are...
It's because in random singlet, the interactions don't fall off exponentially with the distance. And I think to really have localization, you may need the effective interactions to fall off exponentially, you know, simple exponential with the distance.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So at this point in the talk, what I always do is try to make a list of contrasts between the MBL phase and the thermal phase. And what are the notable differences between these two phases? Okay. And then, of course, here there is this poorly understood new type of quantum phase transition, which isn't a thermodynamic phase transition. It's an eigenstate phase transition, or it's a dynamic phase transition. Okay, so in the thermal phase, as I said yesterday, the system is a reservoir successfully. Its own dynamics brings it to thermal equilibrium. Here it's not. Right, so that's one of the essential contrasts. Here we have strictly zero DC conductivity. Actually, even stronger than that. Actually, let me conductivity, even the nonlinear terms are zero. Okay, so it's zero in linear response and zero even in nonlinear response. So you can put a temperature gradient, a finite temperature gradient, and you get zero thermal transport. Whereas over here, there is transport. It can be subdiffusive. So just because a system thermalizes does not mean it has standard hydrodynamics. It might have some subdiffusive transport, and we believe that is the case in the thermal phase near the transition due to quantum Griffiths effects. And I'll maybe get to that, or probably not. Okay, so dimension. So I used to say, so this is again one of these, you know, this field, you know, there's more people entering the field, bringing more arguments, and positions that I used to take rather strongly, I've had to retract because people gave arguments, not that convinced me I was wrong, but convinced me I might be wrong. So I used to say, the dimension doesn't matter, right? And then I said, oh, one dimension is special because, you know, there are actually these Griffiths effects in particular are much more potent in one dimension, because what happens in one dimension, if you're in the thermal phase but you have a rare region that's insulating just by chance, it blocks the transport. Whereas in two dimensions, you can go around it, right? So then 1D became special. But now there's an argument from the same people who are arguing about this, but in this case, I think I believe them a little more, that many-body localization might not actually be stable as a true phase, meaning a sharp distinction which is there in the thermodynamic limit and the long-time limit, except in one dimension. So there's a possibility, again, this is being discussed, that MBL is special to one dimension. So probably it's best to say what I'm saying is for one dimension. We believe MBL is really there because we really have a proof about it in one dimension. If there is MBL in more than one dimension, what I'm going to say is still true, right? But it might be there is no MBL in more than one dimension. There might be, right, you know. Actually, when I got into this game, you know, these people here, like I said, they did perturbation theory to all orders and they made some good arguments, but we know there are non-perturbative effects in many interesting problems in physics, right? And so when Vadim and I started doing this, I said, oh, let's look at this numerically because we could see non-perturbative effects that they wouldn't be able to see. They're probably wrong and we'll find something, right? And then after a while I realized, oh, they're right in one dimension. But it's still possible, and that's what's being argued now, that there are non-perturbative effects which destabilize the many-body localized phase, except in one dimension where it's safe. Because in one dimension, if you have a system of length L, the density of states is such that the level spacing between the many-body eigenstates is exponentially small in L, because the Hilbert space is exponentially large in L. And then you do perturbation theory and ask about some process that gets you across length L. That's also exponentially small in L, and so it can be much smaller than the level spacing. Right? And localization is basically when the terms which are trying to mix the levels are much smaller than the spacings between the levels, and then they don't mix them successfully. Right? But when you go to more than one dimension, you take a system of L by L, the level spacing is e to the minus L squared. But then there's terms across the whole system of order e to the minus L. Right? And so it's a little more dangerous. Right? It's not a good argument, but it's enough to make me nervous. Right? So, right. So, if you say statements with confidence here, I'm talking about one dimension. Yeah.
Numerically, you don't see nothing about this.
Numerically, you can't do more than one dimension. You can do 16 spins, which in two dimensions is 4x4, and that's pretty much worthless for doing any, for answering these fine questions like, is it really a phase or not, right? Of course, the many-body localization as a phenomenon, which might not actually be a true phase, is definitely there in higher dimensions, right? It's like the glass transition, right? The glass in the window, is it a different phase than the liquid that it got cooled from? Or is this just a quantitative issue, a crossover, right? And that's, there's no issue, you know, there is a glass and it's distinct from the liquid. It's distinct in a way that's quantitative, which is very remarkable, but it might not be a phase transition. And similarly here, we could have a regime that looks many body localized in high dimensions, and we definitely do, but there might not be a true phase transition, right? So, you know, and here I'm making sort of, you know, zero, strictly zero DC, right? DC, it's a limit. Strictly zero, it's a, you know, I'm making strong statements, right? Right? Yeah, it's not so good because in 1D, the conductivity could go to zero, but you could still have subdiffusive transport and it still thermalizes. So the conductivity is not a particularly good order parameter. And in fact, if we have an order parameter, the order parameter is non-zero in the localized phase, I think. I think it's best to, right. Here the eigenstates are thermal. Here the eigenstates deviate from thermal. It's like a spin glass, right? And so the order parameter you would construct for this is like the order parameter in a spin glass, it's the frozen part in the eigenstates. How much do they differ from each other or from thermal? And so I think to the extent you would have an order parameter here, it's non-zero in this phase and go to zero at the transition. But, you know, there's no field theory, so, you know, it would be wonderful if we knew what the order parameter was, because then we could maybe construct a field theory. You know, there's no nonlinear sigma model. You know, single particle localization, there's a nonlinear sigma model and there's a field theory. But for this problem with the many-body problem, there's no such thing yet. Right? Again, that's a challenge for those kinds of people.
Yeah. So for at h equal to zero, supposing you break integrability, supposing you had you started with non-integrable model, then yeah. Of course it's diffusive.
We could have a different model that didn't have this special feature that was integrable
so
in the limit.
It's diffusive.
Where it's translationally invariant. Yeah.
So it starts
like the spin chain I was showing yesterday in zero disorder. It's not integrable, right? So that's a nice model for studying that.
Okay. So then you start diffusive, but then you're saying as you switch on,
as you approach the transition, at some point it becomes subdiffusive.
Okay. So it's
due to Griffith's effects.
Okay.
Due to rare regions which are blocking but that's just in 1D, right? That's just in 1D. Okay, here we have boundary law eigenstate entanglement, entropy, and of course, the entropy in the eigenstates is very much lower than the thermal entropy, whereas over here we have thermal volume law, entanglement entropy. So that's, again, an important contrast. And this makes the ground states, sorry, this makes the eigenstates in the MBL phase in some sense like ground states more generally. And so another feature you have here is you can have what we call localization protected order. Not in this model, but you could make other kinds of models which have symmetries which could be broken. Like you could do an Ising model with no longitudinal field, so it really has an Ising symmetry. And then you can have localized states which break the symmetry, even at infinite temperature in one dimension. So you can have one-dimensional systems with eigenstates which have long-range order. And the reason that's allowed here is because the theorems against that assume equilibrium statistical mechanics, and this is a phase where equilibrium statistical mechanics does not apply. So this order could be some, you know, magnetic long-range order, conventional type of Landau order, or it could be topological order. So you also have various topological phases with topological long-range order in highly excited states, even in one dimension, where the thermal, if the system thermalized, that order would be forbidden by theorems. That's what we mean by localization protected order. So this is a paper, you know, Huse, well, a bunch of people, I think 2013. So that's another interesting feature about the many-body localized phase is you can stabilize ordered phases up at high temperatures. And the reason they're stable is because all the thermal fluctuations are localized, and so the thermal fluctuations don't mess it up because everything's localized. Over here, if you start with a product state and look at the dynamics, the entanglement spreads as, so the entanglement entropy as a function of time grows logarithmically with time. If you start from a product, this is starting from a low entanglement, or a product state. Obviously, if you start from an eigenstate, the entanglement doesn't change because it's a time-independent state. But if you take a typical product state you could prepare where it's not an eigenstate, the entanglement will spread logarithmically with time, whereas over here the spread is entanglement goes power law in time to the 1 over z. Z equals 1 is common. So if you're far enough from the phase transition, the entanglement spreads at the Lieb-Robinson speed. It just spreads ballistically in some sense. But if you're too close to the phase transition, these bottlenecks, which are slowing down the transport and making it subdiffusive, also slow down the spread of the entanglement. And so you have a dynamic exponent z, which can be bigger than 1 and slow it down. And that z goes to infinity when you get to the phase transition. So the z goes to infinity then matches nicely onto this. Okay. And then, like I said, over here you have this local unitary that maps the eigenstates onto product states. Here you don't. And then there's the special case of the fully many-body localized phase where you have these localized conserved operators. And again, you don't in the thermal phase. And then for this phase transition, like I said, so you know, we know a lot about other kinds of phase transitions. They have, you know, a beautiful, rich theory. And so it'd be nice to put this phase transition into that classification and see what's there, because we know understanding phase transitions has been a very productive and exciting part of theoretical physics. So for this one, in some sense, you know, we're trying to understand it, and you know, we have an old bag of tricks which worked really well, and so we're trying to fit it into that. And so, you know, you ask about scaling, you ask about universality classes. And we have, you know, crude renormalization groups, very approximate. I think for the renormalization group, we're at the stage of early Kadanoff stuff. Before anything was systematic, it was just totally uncontrolled and heuristic. But we're developing strong randomness renormalization group methods to try to understand this phase transition. And it's interesting, but it's really not under much control at all right now. And so that's a challenge to try to understand this phase transition better than we do. How am I doing? Okay.
So this entropy entanglement increase grows. This is at short times. It eventually saturates.
No, if you had an infinite system, it would just keep going.
But this is for
right. A finite system, it will saturate, but just due to the finite size of the system. Yeah, but in the finite size system, it will saturate, but typically at a level that's below. It'll saturate actually at a volume law, but it'll be subthermal.
Boundary law.
No, it's boundary law in the eigenstate. So this is another one of the things I missed. So we figured, all the eigenstates only have area law entanglement. So that's just the whole story. But in fact, okay, so this is what I want to do next, if I can, in just a couple minutes. Okay, so if we have all, so let's go into the fully many-body localized phase. And we have all these conservation laws. So the tau iz's all commute with the Hamiltonian. So if I write the Hamiltonian in terms of these pseudospins tau, it doesn't contain any x or y terms, because if it did, it wouldn't commute with the Hamiltonian. So this implies, so the L-bit Hamiltonian, this is what we call the L-bit Hamiltonian, which is when we take the Hamiltonian and we write it in terms of the L-bits. The L-bits are Pauli operators, and so they have x and y components. But the L-bit Hamiltonian is an Ising model, right? Because in order to have the Hamiltonian commute with every tau z, it has to be an Ising model. It can't have any x or y components because it wouldn't commute, right? So what the Hamiltonian looks like is this in terms of the L-bits, sum on I, sum renormalized field, tau iz plus sum over ij, jij, twiddle, tau iz, tau jz, plus sum over ijk, kijjk. You get the idea. So it's got single spin terms, two spin terms, three spin terms, etc. The series goes on forever. That's perturbation theory. It generates those terms order by order. So we expect in the localized phase, these terms fall off, both as you go to higher order terms, because those are generated at higher order in perturbation theory, and as you go to larger distances. So this is a complete sum over all pairs. But the interactions that get generated here, we expect them to fall off exponentially with distance as well. Actually, let me be a little more precise. We expect that typically they fall off exponentially with distance, and the cases where they don't are exponentially rare, right? So the exponential is bounding both the typical and the probability of being atypical. Okay, so if we have a Hamiltonian like this, so let's now start with a state. So this is now real space, and let's look at a spin here, and let's start at somewhere not along the z-axis. Let's say a tau spin. So this is now a tau operator. And I've started it not in an eigenstate, so it's got some xy components. And here's another one over here. So this is tau 1 and tau, let's say tau 0 and tau r, distance r, right? Okay, now if we, and then the rest of the system has its taus, but let's just ask, what's the interaction Hamiltonian here in terms of these two operators, right? And so this Hamiltonian is going to look like some effective interaction tau 0z tau rz plus other terms, right? So there's going to be a term which couples these two, right? And then there'll be a whole bunch of other terms. But in particular, these two will be coupled only by their z components and with an interaction which falls off exponentially with distance, okay? So that's a simple two-spin problem you can solve. So you might think the Ising model with two spins doesn't have any interesting physics in it. But it's not true. This is a quantum model, and the x and y components of this spin are precessing at a rate in their, on their block sphere that's set by whether this spin is up or down, because this guy generates a field on this guy. And these guys are precessing at a rate that depends on whether this is up or down. So that generates entanglement between these two. So even if these start off in a product state, on a time scale set by 1 over the interaction, they will become entangled, right? So J goes as e to the minus r over some decay length, and they become entangled at, you know, time scale such that t goes as 1 over j, right? And this goes as e to the plus r over zeta. So you see the entanglement, the distance over which entanglement spreads due to a Hamiltonian like this grows logarithmically with time, right? If I just solve this here, you know, of course, there's a prefactor, but so this is the basic mechanism by which entanglement spreads logarithmically in time. In the localized phase, you know, just an Ising model with no transverse terms has interesting entanglement dynamics. And that was the surprise, right? Because naively you'd think, oh, it's just an Ising model. There's nothing going on there that's interesting. But it's not true. And this was, these, both our work, you know, these two papers, the papers that produce this L-bit model, these guys here, basically one of the motivations for this happening was, is there were some numerics done by Jens Bardersen, Frank Pullman, and Joel Moore observing this spread. Initially, they thought, oh, it's not localized, right? Because naively, we thought it shouldn't spread. But then after a while, we realized, oh, that's actually what it should do if it's localized, right? And that's what really motivated those theory papers to be written. It was to explain the numerical observation that it spreads logarithmically in time. So that was something where, you know, there was a surprising or an unanticipated numerical result which drove the theory forward a bit, which was nice.
So do you need many body localizations to get the log t, or did you have?
Well, you need interactions that go exponential with the distance, right? So if your bare Hamiltonian is just short range, you know, if you have a model where the bare Hamiltonian is just short range, then, you know, it's only if you're in the many-body localized phase, you generate effective interactions between these emergent conservation laws, which fall off exponentially with the distance, and then you get this spreading. Right? If I just took a short-range Ising model without the power, without the exponential tail, I wouldn't get that spreading. Right? But you're right. I could just make an Ising model and just say the interactions fall off exponentially with the distance, and then, well, it is many-body localized, right? Right. Of course, this model is many-body localized because it does have these conservation laws. Right. So I think you need, yeah, I think to get the log t, I don't know of any way to get s growing as log t without many-body localization or without, right, and sometimes the many-body localization is just trivially there because, you know, it's sort of there because, right, if you have single-particle localization in all states, you have many-body localization, right? So, but yeah, I'm not aware of any other way to get it, but, you know, that's, I think I should call that the end of today's lecture. Right. So I guess we have a break, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Okay.
take a few questions if there are. Okay, let me ask a quick question. So supposing you take a classical system, like a bunch of oscillators with different frequencies, right? And then put in nonlinear interactions.
Yeah.
Okay, so then is there a proof that that you don't get localized? I mean, the localization goes away immediately. Is there a proof? I mean, like the if I still do perturbation?
No proofs. You know, that's the KM problem in the limit of an infinite number of degrees of freedom. You know, this is super hard. There's an argument, so we can just do this model classically, right? So we could just say these are classical spins, meaning vectors, you know, infinite spin limit, right? And this is a Hamiltonian, which gives just precessional dynamics, so it's just a classical Heisenberg model, and we believe this model does not have a localized phase when it's classical, and what's the reason? So the story, which I think is the correct physics, goes like this. So we have this long chain. Now we turn on the weak. Also, we studied this numerically. So first we looked at this numerically thinking we would find many body localization. And of course, classical, you can do good numerics, right? Because it's classical. And we thought, oh, that's a good way to study many body. It's a phenomenon happening at high temperatures. Classical physics should apply. Let's try. But after a while, we realized, no, this is wrong because, right. Yeah, Michael Fisher used to say quantum mechanics is irrelevant, referring to at non-zero temperature, but it's not true for all questions you ask. So let's consider such a model. Okay, so we have these random fields, and then we turn on a weak J, right? And so what's going to happen is when you have two nearby spins or three nearby spins that whose frequencies add up to zeros, you get a resonance, right? And you get some chaos, right? And elsewhere it's fine perturbatively because the KM would say that. And so what you get is these little islands of chaos, right? Just places you get some chaos. And how far apart are they? It's of order 1 over J. Right, because in order to get the chaos, we need the resonance to the precision J, right? Because otherwise they're not resonant, right? So you get these islands of chaos at distance 1 over J from each other. So basically what you have a picture now is you've got these insulators, and then you got these little islands. Now, classical physics has the property that with just 2 degrees of freedom and nonlinearity, you can make real chaos, which has a continuous spectrum. And so this little region will thermalize everything nearby, right? Because it has weight in its spectral function that's resonant with every spin nearby, right? In a quantum system, that can't happen, right? A quantum system, in order to get a continuous spectrum with spin of halves, you have to take the thermodynamic limit, right? A finite number of spins, the spectrum is discrete. There's no real continuous spectrum, right? And so the idea is, these little islands will, in some sense, thermalize everything nearby, right? And then the question is, what about energy transport from here to here, right? So that has to go through this insulator, right? And if you think of this insulator, you know, it's you do the harmonic theory of it, you know, it's an insulator, and so it's a tunneling process, right? And so the coupling from here to here will give a relaxation time for an energy difference from here to here, which is e to the minus 1 over J. And so we believe there is a non-perturbative effect. If when you do perturbation theory in J classically, even in one dimension, there's to all order. So the Russians are right. To all orders in perturbation theory, there's no transport, but there is a non-perturbative effect, and I think this is the physics of the non-perturbative effect. Now, of course, you know, I was actually being a little unjust because Bosco by himself wrote a paper a little later about exactly this problem and came to the same conclusion. You know, so you know, it isn't that the Russians were wrong. You know, for the quantum problem in one dimension, they were right. For the classical problem, you know, and they were doing just the quantum problem. They weren't doing the classical problem. So that's, I think, an answer to your question. Yeah. So this is, you know, this is a paper, you know, Oganessian, Paul, Hughes, 2009.
Okay, so we meet again at 11:30.